All right. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Peter Desalting with SpaceIntelReport.com. And we're going to be talking about space sustainability now with three of the most dynamic companies in that sector. I'm very happy to have them here. These are companies doing a whole lot more than just delivering PowerPoints to potential customers. We don't have a lot of time to get to it, but I want to start right in without giving a lot of introduction here. And I want to start with Luc Piguet, who's CEO and co-founder of Clearspace. He'll be followed by Nobu Okada, founder and CEO of Astrocale, and Luca Rossettini of Deorbit, also a founder. So all three of these gentlemen have founded their companies and have done the early spade work to get them where they are now. There's still a long way to go, but let me start with Luc. You have the floor.
Okay. My name is Luc Piguet. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Clearspace. Clearspace is a spin-off from the EPFL Space Engineering Center, which has been working for a team that has been working for many years on the problem of space debris. Essentially, this has been triggered on our side by the launch of a CubeSat straight into the field of debris of the Cosmos Iridium in 2009. So during several years, we've been looking for solutions within academia with very limited budgets, with essentially PhDs and postdocs, and decided in 2017 that we should spin off the project into a startup, which has joined several programs, we have been talking with different operators about how to build up a sustainable business case for sustainable space. 2019, we've been selected by ESA to lead the ClearSpace One mission within the ADRIOS program, where the goal is to make a first removal of an ESA-owned object by 2025. So to give you a little perspective about what drives us, essentially is the fact that we see that new space requires new solutions. We're convinced that there's a new way to operate tomorrow. In orbit, that we have to build new solutions to address the future of what space traffic will look like and build up a solution that makes actually space environment sustainable and safe for future generations. That's really what drove our exercise, and mostly with a thought that there's a way to build up something that can make that can be built in a financial viable way. There's another dimension that is really important we looked at, and we realized that essentially this is a problem for everybody. We all coexist in the same orbits. What you see here is a trace of all the orbits of SpaceTrack of four different countries, right? And it demonstrates very clearly that we all essentially coexist in the same space in orbit. So this is typically a problem that has to be that transcends border, continents, and applications as well, because you can have as much military assets as commercial assets in the same space, the same environment. So a solution has to be found that really addresses the problem sustainably for everyone. So as I mentioned at the beginning, we are working today. We kicked off on the 1st of July the ClearSpace One mission in the frame of a preliminary authorization to proceed with ESA. We will be signing the contract with ESA later this year. The project is led by ClearSpace. ClearSpace is the prime for this exercise, which is a little unusual for an ESA mission. But then we have a supply chain of experience and larger industrial partners with whom we actually implement the mission. Today, we have about 20 companies that are in the list of our industrial partners for this mission. In November last year, we received the support from 8 member states to this program, mostly driven by Switzerland and the UK, and then Germany. Portugal made a substantial contribution to the mission. Poland, Sweden, Romania, and Czech Republic are participating as well. So this is typically one example of an international collaboration around the concrete mission. So the mission is planned to fly by end of 2025 and remove an object called the Vespa upper part, which is a payload adapter from the Vega launcher. ESA has a couple of those in orbit. It's a good example because it's an object that reduces substantially the risk of the mission while still in terms of form factor and size being a representative object that allows us to demonstrate a lot of technologies and implement a lot of technologies that are necessary for future services. So the mission profile, shortly how it looks like, is that we're going to launch up to 500 kilometers where we're going to do commissioning and target phasing. Then we will move up to operational altitudes and do far range, close range rendezvous with the target, which is the Vespa, which is at 800 by 600 kilometer elliptical orbits. Then we execute the capture stack configuration and then a deorbiting maneuver for toward a reentry into Earth atmosphere. This is our baseline. Obviously, the commercial service in the future and developing toward a commercial service needs more than that. And our goal is to make sure that we can demonstrate a lot of the technologies necessary to actually build up something that makes commercial sense for operators in the future. So for us, really, one of the basic idea thought is the fact that removing man-made space debris is a responsibility of today's generation to ensure tomorrow's generation can continue to benefit from the space technology and exploration. So this is really what drives us. Today, ClearSpace is a relatively small team. We're about 25. We're going to be 30 at the end of this year. But it's quite a much larger team across Europe for the execution of the mission itself. There's a lot of co-engineering done in this mission, and it's kind of an unusual approach for ESA, which makes it possible to make new things, build up a new way to operate in space. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right. Thank you, Luca. A couple of questions for you before we move on. So you now have one of the fascinating things about what ESA is doing with ClearSpace is I'm not sure any other government is doing something like that. Am I wrong? Outside ESA, is anybody doing this?
Well, actually, JAXA has also started a mission where Nobu will probably present afterwards.
Yes.
So there's today two agencies that are leading a mission toward the removal of the debris in orbits.
Okay. And your contract with ESA that should be signed, I guess, I think it's next month, isn't it?
It's going to
be
signed? That's correct. Yes.
Could you tell us a little bit about two things very quickly? First, you talked about this as being a technology demonstration mission, where your grappling spider goes down into atmospheric reentry with the Vespa upper stage. I guess that's not sustainable as a business model going forward. So you'd want to have a system where you could use it on multiple debris objects. If you could talk about where you are on that just very quickly. And then secondly, a division of the risk. This is a contract where you have to deliver a service to the European Space Agency. All right. So this is a service contract. What risks do they retain and what risks do you assume?
So for the first question, obviously the goal on the long term is to reduce actually the objective, and I think the objective for all of us on this panel is to reduce the recurring cost of a removal, right? How much does it cost to remove one object and bring this cost down to an affordable amount? Mostly because this is the only way to build something that is sustainable when it comes to the service. And typically, there's several ways to do that. One is to distribute the orbiting packs. Another one could be to do multiple removal with one chaser. There's different strategies for that. And for us, clearly, our goal is to reduce this cost. So the multi-removal approach is definitely a way we are looking in. Our goal is to make sure that we align as many of the technologies we develop in this mission with a commercial target. So some of the objectives for the mission from ESA actually were that there's a commercial future, and which is a fantastic thing actually to do for an agency as a way to say, okay, we help getting this started with public fund. We give support to make it happen. But then at the same time, we're really conscious that this has to have a commercial future. This has to go beyond just an agency mission, which creates very interesting discussions with the ESA team and within our industrial team as well. And I think this is definitely the right way to go. It's very hard to imagine that we can completely finance a model that is that will be at the right price tag without support from agencies. So it's really amazing that ESA actually takes the risk to get this mission started, and JAXA does the same. So this is really fantastic news to our sense for the industry and for the future of space sustainability. When it comes to the risk, the way ESA is a complex and a very large machine. ESA has to play with the member states typically, and the engagements of the member states. Typically, the budget is placed on the member states. So, if you want the the financial decider for that kind of mission is the member states. And so the member states imposed a lot of requirements in terms of the way the mission has to be executed, mostly to make sure that we're successful. And this means that a system has been put in place to make sure we go through gates. If you take a normal ESA service, typically what would happen is that ESA would just buy the service, we would deorbit, and then they pay us, right? And there's no reviews or any test or verification, but this is not the case here. So it's really a collaboration with ESA. We have key performance gates we have to get through, where we have deliverable to show, we have KPG, the maturity of technologies to demonstrate, and where essentially ESA does the technical due diligence and the organizational due diligence to make sure that what we put in place actually makes sense. And this significantly reduces the risk, right? At the end, it's ESA that will decide that we're ready for launch. There's a split between the risk. On one hand, ESA says, okay, your risk is to make sure you actually capture something in orbit, and our risk is to make sure you get there, and you get there with the right level of maturity. So that's more or less how this program has been set up, which is quite new for ESA and is, to our sense, a very sensible way to approach the problem.
Okay, well, I got several other questions, but we'll have to hold them in abeyance until the end of the session if we have time. But thank you, Luke. It's a very interesting project that ESA ministers at, what you said, 8 governments, I believe, financed late last year. Let me move over to Japan and Nobu Okada, of the founder and CEO of Astrocale, also a company doing a lot of interesting things, and also a company that recently showed its ability to raise money, which is not such an easy thing when you're talking about the risk profile of the business that Nobu has founded with Astrocale, which is not just orbit removal, also servicing. And Nobu, if you are on, I see you, you have the floor.
Hi, thank you for the introduction, Peter. First of all, thank you for inviting me to Space Forum 2020 Luxembourg to this critical dialogue on space sustainability. I am very pleased to be on this panel because Luke from Clearspace and Luca from Deorbit are kind of first movers and the real space environmentalist who have a real impact on space and the Earth. So I'm very happy to hear. Be here. So thank you very much. So let me share the slides to explain what we're doing. I hope you can see this. Can you see it?
Yep, it's good.
Super. Thank you very much. As Luke said, space is not sustainable anymore. As the density of the space debris has reached to a critical level where chain reaction of collision can happen at any near future. But when we talk about space sustainability is a kind of an overused word. And what does it really mean? It's not about stopping development. It's not just adding cost to the operators. From my viewpoint, it's a future where we have on-orbit servicing, such as active debris removal, life extension, refueling, orbit transfer, manufacturing, and end-of-life management. Why? The on-orbit servicing can expand value chain. So far, we have been in a throwaway culture by doing just R&D, AAV, launch, and operate. But by adding maintenance and disposal, the space industry can be on the same level as the automobile industry, shipping industry, and aviation industry. For example, automobile industry could double by creating the automotive aftermarket, and it could reduce the lifetime cost for the owners and reduce the risk of traffic accidents. In the end, the automobile industry could expand their users. To make it a reality in space, we need a reliable RPO technologies, rendezvous and proximity operation technologies, which is, Luke and Luca are also working on, for both controlled and uncontrolled objects. Uncontrolled objects is the debris. And then we also need the right set of the regulations. The market size of the throwaway culture is $108 billion US dollars per year, And it's too early to say how big the larger space sustainability ecosystem market could become. But there is a clear value in lowering lifetime costs for operators and reducing risks. Astrocale is now preparing four services. One is an end-of-life service to prevent generating future debris. And then also AD active debris removal for existing large object. And then inch-to-SSA service. So if the satellite go defunct, we could not see the real reasons, but our satellite can get there and get pictures and then identify the causes. And also recently we acquired capability for life extension from Effective Space Solutions in Israel. And then we got IP technology and the great team members. And then, so we expanded our service from LEO to GEO with wide range of services. The RPO technologies cut across these areas. We are going to launch ELSA-D, the world's first end-to-end debris removal demonstration. And we already have a flight model, and we are just waiting for shipment timing. We're just waiting. And then the remarkable things of this mission is we will capture uncontrolled object with the tumbling. So how we capture the tumbling object? So our service will synchronize the motion, can dance with the client and capture and stabilize and bring them down to the atmosphere and burn. So we are about to launch. And we have a great control center in UK, which is kind of a very bespoke for on-orbit servicing, which is a very high fidelity simulator and whatever we have. We are also working for active debris removal for large environmentally critical objects, in which, as Luke said, we're working with the JAXA right now. So there are two phases. Now we are in phase one. In phase one, we are selected. And we are working with the JAXA and to get closer to the large object and get the picture and identify the motion and come back. The second phase, we get back again and then capture and remove. You know, we're also developing life extension service in GEO, as I explained. Now we have 140 people with five offices. We're headquartered in Japan, but we have great teams in UK, US, and Singapore and Israel. And then three-fourths of our people are engineers. So we're really technology-oriented company. We are also addressing regulatory matters in the business. As Peter said, we have raised $142 million so far. So that's where we are. We have lots of things to do to make space sustainable, but our team is doing a great job. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Nobu. A couple of questions for you. The ELSA-D, when do you expect that to be launched?
We expect it to launch this year, but we are waiting for the final confirmation from the launcher right now due to the lots of environmental situations.
Yes. So, remind me, which one is this? This is not a PSLV, is it?
It's a Soyuz rocket.
Soyuz, okay. All right. And the large object removal, forgive my ignorance. Now, there's a first phase contract, which is basically rendezvous and proximity, and then a second contract would be for actually removing what looked like a large rocket upper stage. Is that right?
Right. Correct, Peter.
And the selection, has the selection of a particular upper stage been made?
We're still in the discussion right now. So once we have a clear answer, I think we're going to announce it.
Okay. But would it have to be a Japanese rocket upper stage? I guess it might.
I believe it's a Japan origin object.
Okay. Because one of the things about this, about the peculiarity of the industry you guys are all in, and it's a bizarre thing, but that's the way the law is, that you need the permission of the government that launched the upper stage, which is now garbage, need the position, the approval of that government before you can remove it. It sounds,
yeah, so,
but that's what it is.
But unfortunately, there's ownership for the old most of the objects in space, and definitely we should get approval. It costs us more for regulatory stuff, but it's kind of a necessary steps.
Yeah, it drives me nuts every time I think of this, that somebody's left something up there for, I don't know, centuries, and if you want to take it out to the, you know, in the general interest of everyone, you need their permission. Should be obvious, but isn't. A lot of space stuff isn't obvious. All right, Nobu, thank you very much. If we have time at the end, I'll come back to you. Let me move now to Luca Rossettini, CEO and founder of D-Orbit. Luca, I'll let you describe where D-Orbit is and where you're going. You have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm also very happy and proud to be here with Nobu and Luke. We always meet in very good environments, so thank you very much for inviting me. I also have a few slides to present what the company does and also to introduce some elements about the sustainability. So let's share my screen here. Okay. So you should be able to see the screen now.
Yep.
Okay, so the title is Space Logistics and Sustainability, because the business side is always important when we are talking about space. So our vision is really to create an orbital infrastructure that enable business to become profitable, but also work in an environment that is actually sustainable. And I will come later to what I think a good definition of sustainability for space is. So what we do now, we offer end-to-end services to satellite operators. So from manufacturing of the satellite, orbital transportation of satellites in the right position in orbit, orbital operations, and they say end-of-life disposal through systems that you can install on satellites before launch. Our first mission in 2013, we tested a decommissioning system, and then we launched in 2017 a satellite with a decommissioning system on board, our own satellite. And now we are focusing on transporting satellites in orbit. One mission is actually running now, so we have a satellite in orbit right now. The next one will be in December. We are about 80 people, mainly all the production facilities in Italy. We have a company in UK for advanced services, and then in Portugal for all the software operation. We have a hub in US as well. Very quickly through the company, this is actually, it's near Lake Como, so whoever wants to come and visit us, I think it's you can spend a very nice weekend on the lake and visit the orbit as well. Our production facility, some guys working, our mission control center that we have, so we control the satellites directly from our building. And this is what we are doing right now. So this is the current mission. So what you see is a cargo satellite that comes with its own decommissioning system, by the way. So when it reaches orbit, it will deliver a small satellite exactly where they need to be, in order to avoid the like wasting of time from launch to operations. Then you can move to another orbit and release other satellites. And we can transport satellites and other payload for in-orbit validation and demonstration missions. So for all the new companies willing to launch satellites and the existing satellite operators. The next mission is in December, and then we have one in June that, by the way, is open for booking. The advantage that we are going that we are giving to customers is that they reduce the time from launch to revenues by 85% and the overall cost of launching the constellation by 40%. So if we get to the topic sustainability, so how can we enable the concept of sustainability in space? So providing benefits both to business and to, you know, the entire society. So to me, sustainability is durable space business, so a space business without bottlenecks, and benefits for the entire humankind. I mean, the benefits is from space services, I think they are very clear. So we are all benefit from the space activities. What about durable space business? So I think the areas in which we need to focus is, first of all, to eliminate the bottleneck. So allow the space commercial business to become commercial. So we are still at inception. And as you said, most of these activities are still government funded at the moment. And then change the perspective of space debris as just an environmental issue. It's a bottleneck for the business, so it can become an opportunity, a business opportunity. But at the end of the story, we need to arrive to the space circular economy. So to me, there are two, let's say, major steps. First of all, we need to make sure that every satellite shall be properly disposed at the end of life, either with a system on board to be removed right after active debris removal. I'm really agnostic on the solution. We need to act now because, as we saw before, the problem is really, really outstanding. And when I'm talking about space circular economy, there will be a lot of new activities in space that today are still sort of science fiction that we need to think about today. So Nobu already showed all the servicing and the maintenance. That's actually a very important activity. But in the future, we may think to recycle stuff in space directly and manufacture satellites. So we really need to get into a closed loop in space. And that will be the infrastructure that all of us, space companies, will need to support and build in the future. Thank you for that.
All right, thank you, Luca. A couple of questions for you. First, the orbit's working on several different businesses there. What would you judge as the one that's going to offer the most near-term economic success for you? What business is most likely going to see customer response?
Yeah, it's a good question because it's really related to the market readiness and business readiness. So, we started, as I said, in 2011. So we are a kind of old new space companies when the word new space was not there. And we start working on the decommissioning systems. The first barrier that we face is are customers aware of the economic benefit and how can you transfer this economic benefit to the customers and then into the business? And so it wasn't easy, especially because even now satellite operators are busy launching satellites into space. And the end of life, yes, they are aware of the end of life, but it's not yet, the most important part. They are working on that, and that's why the market is going to be created. So as the orbit being created in Europe, where, the lack of financing for startups and scale-up companies, it's very clear, we decide to go step by step. So we are developing technologies that could be built on top of the existing technology in order to arrive also to serve satellite operators in the larger perspective in the future. But at the moment, our core business is transportations into orbit, into the precise orbit, and offering to the current customers the possibility to have on board their own decommissioning system. And then, of course, we will take care of decommissioning our own cargo.
Okay, and one last one, because I'm over time and I apologize to the organizers, but this was a worthwhile session. The decommissioning system, give us an idea of what that adds to the total mass of the satellite, whether just if I'm a satellite operator with a 3U CubeSat, I'm probably not going to use that. It's too small. But how small a satellite can you accommodate without, doubling the weight of the thing?
Yeah. So the decommission system is, we have a small system for CubeSat, but I have to say that the real decommissioning system is designed for larger satellites, both for LEO and for GEO. So the question you're asking, so what is the mass? Actually, this is a common question that everybody asks in the space sector, but we should ask what is the benefit that I'm having decommissioning the satellite, right? So anyway, the mass is 1%, between half to 1% of the mass of a geostationary satellite. And then for a LEO satellite, it's between 5 and 10%, depending if you want a direct reentry. So 1 hour reentry of your satellite. But the benefit in terms of life extension and extra revenues, avoiding collision with the same satellite of your own constellations and so on, is actually 10 times the cost that you are experiencing for having this on board.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Well, I appreciate your time, Luca. And Luke and Zobo, we do not have any more time for this. I'm already way over. So thank all three of you gentlemen for your time. We'll be hearing a lot more about all three of your companies in the coming months, and at least for one of you, the coming weeks.